So we are very, very fortunate to have His Grace Ram Giridhari Prabhu with us. Today's class will be given by His Grace Ram Giridhari Prabhu, and we are continuing from Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Leela Chapter 20. Thank you, Prabhu. You can take over. And in case there is any problem with the call, Pavitra Madhavi Mataji will connect you again. Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Please take over. Prabhuji, you're on mute.
Yeah. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. We cannot hear you. Can you unmute your phone?
Yeah. Prabhuji, you can take over. I think he's been unmuted and he's still on the call, but we are not able to hear him. Pavitra Madhavi Mataji, do you want
yes.
to try?
Yes, Mataji, I can call him again.
Okay, thank you, Mataji.
He's in hot call, so like maybe he first drop and then I can call. So I'll try, otherwise I can message him to drop the call.
Yeah.
Okay, Mataji.
He is muting and unmuting. I think he's trying hard, but yeah, you can connect him for the time being.
Okay.
Let's see.
Okay, yeah. Mataji.
Yeah. Hare Krishna, can you hear me?
Yes, Prabhuji, we can
hear you.
Prabhuji, you can take over.
Now we can't hear him again.
Let's see if she's able to connect him now. Probably restart the recording.
We can hear you, Prabhu.
So today's class will be given by His Grace Ram Giridhari Prabhu. Prabhuji, please take over.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Jaya Jaya Sri Chaitanya Jaya Nityananda. Jaya Dvaita Chandra Jaya Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Jaya Jaya Sri Chaitanya Jaya Nityananda. Jaya Dvaita Chandra Jaya Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Today we are reading from Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Leela, Chapter 20, text number 302 to all the way till 305. This is from Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instruction to Sanatana Goswami in the Science of the Absolute Truth. I'll read the text and translation and purports, then we can discuss. Text 302. Bhakti Mishra Krita Punye Kona Jivottama Rajogune Vibhavita Kari Tandramana. Because of his past pious activities mixed with devotional service, the first class living entity is influenced by the mode of passion within his mind. Text 303. Garbhodaga Shai Dwara Shakti Sanjari Yashti Shrishti Kare Krishna Brahma Rupa Dhari. Such a devotee is empowered by Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. In this way, an incarnation of Krishna in the form of Brahma engineers the total creation of the universe. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. The Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu, Purusha Avatara expansion of Lord Vishnu, accepts the material modes, Sattva Guna, Raja Guna and Tama Guna, and thus incarnates as Lord Vishnu, Brahma and Shiva. These are incarnations of material qualities. among the many superior living entities qualified with pious activities and devotional service, one called Lord Brahma is infused with the quality of passion by the supreme will of Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. Thus, Lord Brahma becomes the incarnation of the creative energy of the Lord. Text number 304. Bhashvanitasma sakaleshu nijeshu tejat sriyam kiyat prakadayatyapi tatva datra brahmaya yesha jagadanda vidana karta govindam adipurusham tamaham bhajami. The sun manifests his brilliance in a gem, although it is stone. Similarly, the original personality of Godhead, Govinda, manifests his special power in a pious living entity. Thus the living entity becomes Brahma and manages the affairs of the universe. Let me worship Govinda, the original personality of Godhead. Purport. This is a quotation from Brahma Sarita 5.49. 305. Kona kalpayada yogya jivana hi paya apane ishvara tabilyam se brahma haya. If in a kalpa a suitable living entity is not available to take charge of Brahma's post, the Supreme Personality of Godhead Himself personally expands and becomes Lord Brahma. One day of Brahma consists of the four yugas multiplied 1,000 times, or according to solar calculation, 4, 3, 2, and almost 9 times 0 years, and such also is the duration of his night. 1 year of Brahma's life consists of 360 days and nights, and Brahma lives for 100 such years. Such is the life of a Brahma. So we will discuss still this verse, because the next verse talks about the Rudra incarnation. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yenam Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swamin Iti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Sunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadha Srivasadi Gauravakta. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So today we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhyalila, chapter 20, text number 302 to 305. But actually I wanted to read the 306 also, because that's the whole discussion about Brahma. So let me read 306 before we start our discussion. Yashyangri Pankajarajo Kilaloka Palair Mauli Uttamair Dritam Upashita Tirtha Tirtham Brahma Bhavoham Apiyasya Kala Kalaya Shishodavimaschiramasya Nirpashanam Kavam. What is the value of a throne to Lord Krishna? The masters of the various planetary systems, such various planetary systems, accept the dust of his lotus feet on their crowned heads. That dust makes the holy places sacred, and even Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, Lakshmi, and I myself, who are all portions of his plenary portion, eternally carry that dust on our heads. Purport. This is a quotation from Srimad Bhagavatam. When the Kauravas flattered Baladeva so that he could become their ally and spoke ill of Sri Krishna, Lord Baladeva became angry and spoke this verse. So first of all, thank you so much for engaging me in this service regularly, and it's a pleasure to be with you all as always. And right now I'm in southern India, in Srirangam, very close to Srirangam. I'm not exactly in Srirangam, but just very close to Srirangam, and by the mercy of Guru and Gauranga, able to share some wisdoms from the pages of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. So, Mahaprabhu is very elaborately, very systematically, and very categorically explained different details of Krishna consciousness. So he finished discussing about all the Purusha avatars. Then he is now starting to explain about the Guna avatar. So whilst explaining about his Guna avatar, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is, as usual, getting into the details of them. And as he explained those details, Srila Prabhupada is revealing some interesting insights. And as we regularly chant these verses, so we will chant this five verses, verse number 302 to all the way till 306. As a part of our discussion today, we will have four sets of reflections. And through these reflections, let's understand these four or five verses. First, before we get into the reflection, we all need to know, I'm not sure how many of you know this, Brahma, the position of Brahma, the word Brahma is actually a post. Brahma is not a person. I mean, of course, Brahma is a person in the sense that a person who occupies the post of Brahma keeps changing after one life of Brahma. And the life of Brahma is very nicely, with the numerical number Srila Prabhupada has explained that, like all of us, he also lived for a specific number of years. And his total calculation is that he also lived for 100 years. And his 100 years calculation is, pretty huge there. It's in verse number 305. So, Brahma is a post. And who can occupy Brahma's post depends on various factors. So, hence, we need to understand that even if you become Brahma, a Brahma Bhuvana Loka, Punar Avartina Arjuna, Maam Upetyat Kaunteya, Punar Janmana Vidyate. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna very nicely explains, even if you become Brahma, Brahma is the first citizen in this material world. He is like a mayor in a city. Because there are a lot of universes, and every universes are governed by different Vishnus. We must have discussed in the creation episode, we must have discussed in the previous few set of verses. So in every universe, there is a Brahma who governs, somewhere 400, somewhere 1000, somewhere 1000. And each of these Brahma have their stipulated time period in which they manage this universe. And these Brahmas are all subservient to the Supreme Lord. So we need to understand that even if you become Brahma of any universe, Punar Janma is definitely a must for that person. Once the duration is getting over, this Brahma, even if it's Brahma or even if it is Indra, even if it is any other demigod, they may have to come down. In our discussion last week, when Lord Shiva or something related to Lord Shiva was there, he mentioned that the position of Lord Shiva is though pretty unique, unlike Lord Brahma, because Brahma falls within this material world, 14 planetary systems, but the position of Shiva is just above this material world, just above the Satyalok, and hence position of Lord Shiva is a bit unique. It is explained that by performing some very pious activities, a spirit soul can become Brahma, but to become Lord Shiva or Rudra is almost impossible. It is like there are certain posts, there are certain services, there are certain positions that are permanently fixed, and they are called Nitya Siddhas, they are called eternally liberated souls, and there are some of them are eternally residing in the spiritual world. So those are all not available for you know, those services are already booked. But there are some services of Krishna which are on rotational basis, depends upon individual's accumulated pious and impious activities. So we need to understand that even Brahma has got his ultimatum at some point in time. So through this 6 verses, we are going to have 4 sets of reflections. The first one is about a set of 4 points. If you see in verse number 305, it is very nicely explained, if in a kalpa, a suitable living entity is not available to take charge of Brahma's post, the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself personally expands and becomes Lord Brahma. So, the realization here is about Krishna is Swarat. In Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st canto, 1st chapter, 1st shloka, Yannadhyasyetaha, in that, Srila Prabhupada explains elaborately on this particular point how Krishna is Swarat, fully independent and fully cognizant. So, how is this Swarat nature of the Supreme Lord exist? Because Krishna is also called Rasaraj. Krishna is also called Bhaktavatsala. Krishna is also called Radhika Raman. Krishna is also have many, many names. So when Krishna is performing various leela, when he is busy with this protecting his devotees, when he is creating universes, there are 2 types of functions. One is where he himself expands as Swamsa, where he also expands as Vibhinnamsa, separated expansion. So when this is happening, how this Swarat nature is exhibited by the Lord? In his own capacity, Krishna personally participates in some set of services, but for certain managerial services, he nominates some special devotees. He appoints some very personally chosen qualified devotees. As explained by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in verse number 302, past pious activities as well as devotional service and as well as that person being first class in nature will get qualified to become Brahma. So, it is perfectly possible if we do some pious activities, punya karma, we can elevate up to the level of becoming Brahma. So, Krishna mentions in 305, the sloka 305, it is mentioned that if somebody is not suitable enough with this combination for whatever, you know, God-known reason, then Krishna expands himself and becomes Brahma. So the realization is, in this, what are the 4 points in the first set of realization is, Krishna is Swarat, number 1. And just because Krishna is Swarat, Krishna manages to take care of all himself by appointing his own agents, and otherwise he himself does it. Which means service of the Supreme Lord are unlimited. There are plenty of services that are available for the Supreme Lord that if anybody elevates his consciousness to become a sincere servant of the Supreme Lord, they get service opportunity. So there is no shortage of services. And
Krishna is eager to engage all of us in his service because Krishna wants us to be around him. And if we don't latch on to those service opportunities, it's we who are the loser, not the Supreme Lord. These four points forms one cluster of understanding. Krishna is Supreme Personality of Godhead and he is Swaraj. He is fully independent. While he is independent, he is definitely engaging, interested in engaging all of us in the service because there are unlimited services. And if we do not qualify ourselves to the service, Krishna is not bereft of any opportunities. Krishna is not just going to suffer. He can manage his own services by expanding himself. So the loser is never Krishna. So many a times in our conditional nature, we may out of amateurish, childish tendency, we may try to penalize the service. We may try to forego some service. We may try to think that if I don't do the service, let me see who else can do the service. Sometimes you may get the feeling that I am doing something great, so let me get some credit. All those feelings are crushed when you read these 5-6 verses. Because here Krishna says, yes, for doing some of my administrative function, I nominate some living entity. But guys, don't think that I am dependent on him. I am independent of him. If he does his service, great, glorious, it is for his benefit. In the very next verse, it is very nicely clarified. Or the previous verse probably. So the point is, I perform, I shine, I glow, not because of my existence, it is because of the Supreme Lord's governance, Supreme Lord's mercy upon me. And example given here is, the sun manifests his brilliance in a gem, even though the gem is a stone. Because of the sun hitting that stone, this gem becomes very, very valuable and glowing nicely. Similarly, this whole prayer Brahma himself says in Brahma Samhita. Similarly, in our own existence of Krishna consciousness, there are unlimited services, and hence each and every one of us need to understand Krishna is Swaraj, Krishna is Rasaraj, Krishna is Jagannath, Bhaktavatsala, Radhika Raman, and hence it is our prerogative to enable ourselves to behave in such a way that we get the service opportunity. If we don't, the loser is us. Krishna is saying this to Arjuna in Bhagavad Gita very clearly. The Dharma Yuddha is already destined to happen and I have already made up my mind. It is your choice whether you want to participate and take some credit and get some mercy or just move on and suffer and my agenda will keep continuing to happen. So the reflections here are that we need to constantly remember that my being in Krishna consciousness is for my progress and it has nothing to do with anybody else. Hence, we should never get into a mindset to think that I am the doer. Prakriti kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvasaha ahankara bhimudatma karta aham iti manyate. So karta aham iti manyate, Krishna says, if somebody starts to think I am the doer, it is because of me something is happening, it is because of me something is existing, then that person is definitely in his egoistic position and that person is called vimura. A person whose intelligence is lost. So our first set of reflections is to help us to restate, re-clarify that Krishna is Swaraj, not only from his Leela perspective, but from the entire cosmic manifestation's existence perspective. If no one else is qualified enough, Krishna can, Krishna will manifest, expand himself and manage his activities. And this, incidentally, in the case of Brahma, Krishna is doing more than once. Here he is talking about creation and Brahma's post by itself. In Brahma Vimohan Leela, he is actually demonstrating that to Brahma. Because Brahma got in a small, minuscule situation of trying to get into an egoistic stance that how come this small boy could be the Lord? Because the Supreme Lord, whom I saw, few verses before we had discussed how Brahma was born from the lotus petal, came out of the navel of the navel of Vishnu, and Brahma is going the entire stem, top to bottom, and going all over the place to see what he is supposed to do. Then he's hearing a sound called ta pa ta pa. Then he's doing a meditation. Then the Supreme Lord is revealing entire cosmic manifestation, spiritual world, and everything else. And there is a heart-to-heart revelation by the Supreme Lord. Chaturshloki Bhagavatam was spoken. So many of those things we must have discussed. But then, that Brahma, who saw Krishna in a different capacity, when he saw Krishna playing in Vrindavan, he got bewildered, and whatever he did, we all knew that. As Brahma Vimohan Leela, Krishna expanded himself and told Brahma, saying that what he can do is only external and what I can do is beyond comprehensible. So Krishna is time and again clarifying. If we try to prove a point, if we try to test a point, if we try to kind of question the Krishna's supremacy, then our existence is challenged. It is we who are the losers and not the Supreme Lord. That's our first set of reflection. The second point that I want to say is Krishna being the doer, and not only he is the doer, he is also the benefactor. So hence, we just need to allow the Lord and his devotees to act on us rather than stop us. So what does Krishna want to do? Krishna somehow or other want to engage us in his service in a capacity where we can get purified of our contamination. So technically speaking, Krishna is a doer because as is explained that Bhaswa Netasva Sakaleshu Nijeshu Tejaha. Tejaha means brilliance. It is because of Krishna's effulgence. It is Krishna's illumination, illuminating effect. So we are all glowing, we are all existing. That is why one devotee very nicely explained this point. Many a times we think Krishna is the Supreme Lord, but my source of maintenance is myself. We start to think, I am maintaining myself because I work. I am surviving because of my salary. I am able to do certain things because of I do a hard labor. So the principle that is that is probably the source of income could be our hard work. But our source of maintenance is always the Supreme Lord. If source of income is the source of maintenance, then every rich guy could be happy and every poor guy could definitely be suffering. But that's never the case. Source of income is never the source of maintenance. The source of maintenance is always the Supreme Lord, and not only the source of maintenance is the Supreme Lord, benefactor is also the Supreme Lord. The beneficiary, ultimate beneficiary is also the Supreme Lord. So our second realization is that Krishna is not only the doer, but also the benefactor. Hence, as practicing devotees, We just need to allow the Lord or and His devotees to work on us so that our existence can be purified and we become useful. I gave you this example of the hair. The hair is a beautifying component in our head. Only when the hair is attached to the body, the nails are sometimes shown as a beauty in the women, only when it is attached to the fingers. So long as we are attached to the source, the beauty of that is definitely visible. But the same hair or the nails, which were beautiful just 2 minutes before, when it is plucked off the body, it is counted as killed, useless, dirty, and rejected. Hence, as practicing devotees, we should allow the Lord to act upon us. By allowing the Lord to act upon us, our life will come on a track which otherwise was not on track. So the second realization is that in spite of us, if we are Krishna consciousness, it is because of the Lord and His devotees. So if we are not Krishna conscious, the responsibility is upon us, not upon anybody else. If we are Krishna conscious and making a progress, the responsibility is because of Vaishnavas and the Supreme Lord upon us. So hence, we need to agree and understand that our source of maintenance is always the Supreme Lord and not by our own endeavor. Our endeavor are generally meant to do karma. Karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. Adhikar is given for us to karmanyeva. So you just perform your duties. So the results are supposed to be offered to the Supreme Lord. You don't have any adhikar because the results are sanctioned, results are controlled by the Supreme Lord. The second realization hence is the source of maintenance is always the Supreme Lord, even though the source of income could be by our hard labor. And hence, let the Lord be the doer, and the Lord be the benefactor, and let us allow the Lord and His dear devotees to work upon us in such a way that we become useful, insignificantly significant spirit soul in His service. So that is our second realization. So third realization is a set of 5 points. Whilst we discuss the Lord is Swarat, second we discuss the Lord is a maintainer, and we also mentioned that how there are unlimited services. We need to know some Siddhanta around services, because if the services to the Supreme Lord are not properly understood, it may create a big confusion. So hence the third set of realization is about how and when our services to the Supreme Lord becomes useful. So point number A of this third realization is, many a times we see devotees trying to talk about mode of goodness, trying to talk about being peaceful, settled, calm, quiet, serene, secluded, so many things. But please understand, here we see Lord Brahma has assumed the mode of passion for doing a service for the Supreme Lord. So there's a very tricky, subtle point that I want to make and should not be misunderstood is, if the agenda is to full and fully serve the Supreme Lord, and there is no personal attachment, then even being passionate is glorious. Even in being mode of ignorance, he is accepted. Because the intent is, somehow or the other, the Supreme Lord's service are supposed to be taken care nicely. So, as devotees, sometimes we may amateurishly say that I won't do that service because it is in the mode of passion. It is very aggressive. It is very passionate. Can you think, Brahma, who saw the spiritual world? Who saw the entire creation? Who saw everything and finally decided to be participating in the creation service? Of course, he got it managed through his agents. But then finally he is holding the responsibility. So, in our service opportunity, what needs to be seriously thought about is who is the beneficiary, rather than thinking that this is service in the mode of ignorance or passion or whatever that is. So there are two aspects of it. One is the consciousness in which I do the service. Number two, the nature of the service. The consciousness in which I do the service is extremely important, and it needs to be mode of goodness and above. So the nature of service could be anything. It could be of passionate in nature. It could be of goodness in nature. It could be of ignorance in nature. It could be of anything for that matter, because the beneficiary is the Supreme Lord. The second part of this third realization is that when we are executing a service to the Lord, we need to take that much which we can chew. Once Mother Urmila told this to me personally, that Srila Prabhupada once mentioned that if somebody takes up the service and that he accepts them, which he cannot handle it, or trying to commit ourselves into a service which we can't manage, it is also a kind of an offense. So the point, the reason I'm trying to bring this is, Brahma's post, the reason Lord Krishna is trying to expand himself and take up that service is because if he does not find a suitable candidate who can exactly fit into this framework, which is about having some passion, having some devotional nature, and being a first-class living entity, and doing this with full commitment, then Krishna does not enable anybody else, he himself does it. It is like Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada definitely depended himself on his disciples, but each and every disciple shared his realization that the services that we are doing is possible only because of the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. Even though apparently some services were taken or given, if they were empowered by Srila Prabhupada, then the services were fully executed for the pleasure of Srila Prabhupada. But if somebody tried to take up a service to show off or assume a service to overpower, then that person's ego is crushed. So the second part of this third realization is that we need to take upon services that which we can chew, that which we can execute within our capacity, and not try to assume something which we can't handle. Because it is in the perspective that the Supreme Lord needs to be satisfied, not our personal ego. And a third aspect of this realization is that it is similar to the point number two, but I want to explicitly make it, is that we as devotees need to learn amongst ourselves to under-promise and over-deliver, in the sense that somehow or the other, we need to have a very high level of integrity and commitment in what we accept for the Supreme Lord, because the Lord is expecting our service for our benefit, not for His benefit. So sometimes, because of we doing the services, we should not get carried away, and that situation is detrimental for our own existence. Hence, let us learn to give a very positive experience to our own fellow devotees and definitely make them progress in their devotional life by our integrity in devotional service as well as our commitment to this devotional service. So Brahma, and you are going to see Lord Shiva and others, is definitely a candidate which Lord Krishna personally chose, so that the entire administrative nature in this cosmic manifestation is very nicely taken care, and Krishna can peacefully, very nicely enjoy his leelas with his pure devotees. As it is always spoken, gopis are unique, gopis are special for one particular characteristics of them, which is that all of them, individually, their only desire is that Krishna needs to be pleased. If a gopi sees Krishna getting attracted to another gopi, she is not going to get envious. She is going to enhance, she is going to serve, she is going to glorify that gopi in such a way that Krishna's attraction towards them increases. Of course, we have leelas where the competitive spirits have been exhibited, but they are all meant for jokes and sport and not out of envy and pride and ego. So hence, the third part of the third realization is that as practicing devotees within ISKCON movement, there is a highest demand and need that we show utmost level of integrity as well as commitment, so that this movement can go on for the next 10,000 years. Now, His Holiness Bhaktacharya Maharaj once answered this in a Bhagavatam class in Mayapur. A devotee asked Maharaj that, Maharaj, Srila Prabhupada has mentioned that his books will be the law books for the next 10,000 years, so which means that ISKCON will be there for the next 10,000 years? So Maharaj thought for a while and said that is a very good question. And he said that if ISKCON is going to be there or not, it's pretty much in our hands. But Srila Prabhupada's books are going to be the law book for the next 10,000 years. It's already stated and declared. Hence, our duty as a strict, sincere practitioner is to somehow or other keep up this commitment. This, the point of integrity and commitment is extremely important if at all we want to serve the Supreme Lord nicely. And the fourth aspect of our understanding about the service attitude is that we should not, need not compare and evaluate our service with anybody else's service. That's because our service is our transaction with Krishna and has nothing to do with others. Somebody else might be doing very nicely. Somebody else might be underperforming. There's nothing to do with our quality of service. And hence, we are not doing service for satisfying, for showing to anybody else. It is purely a transaction between ourselves and the Supreme Lord. And hence, the last realization, last part of the third realization is that let's improve upon our service. Let us invest our entire ability and consciousness in the service. And by that, let's inspire everyone else to get in the same group. So hence, the third set of realization is about that whilst the service opportunities are unlimited, at the same time, Krishna being Swarat, let's learn to do service in a way by which we progress in Krishna consciousness and Krishna is pleased. So we discuss these five sets of points. And the last realization, hence, is a very fundamental observation in this movement, at least amongst some practicing growing devotees, even though it is slightly a caveat from the 5-6 verses that we read, I thought it is important, I'll just highlight them. This is about basic nature that devotees have picked up off late, where when your Lord comes to my house, is no more my Lord attitude. In a sense, your Krishna is your Krishna only in your house. When that Krishna comes to my house, is no more my Krishna kind of attitude. What is this? When the service you do it is different, when I do it different, when the service is done at your place is different, the service, the same service done at my place is different. So we start to kind of build a competitive and a very amateurish spirit. And the reason I linked this point in this current context is that here this Gunavatar, Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu expands himself as the Gunavatar purely for a specific agenda. Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport in verse number 303, these are incarnations of material qualities. Among the many superior living entities qualified with pious activities and devotional service, one called Lord Brahma is infused with the quality of passion by the supreme will of Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. Thus, Lord Brahma becomes incarnation of the creative energy of the Lord. So, all the activities are happening by the supreme will of the Lord. So, if the Lord wishes some specific devotee to be benefited with specific qualities and service opportunities, it is our duty to enhance, facilitate, support, and cherish, rather than feeling that if it's taken off my hand, it's no more my service, I will not be, you know, taking care of that or looking into it. And it's also, in this part, I want to just say a caveat. It's also very important that when we are serving the Supreme Lord, how do we handle our worship towards demigods? So this fourth point is about two aspects of it. One is how the same service that you do is passed on to somebody else. The same deities that you worship is being asked to worship by somebody else. The same set of devotees with whom you deal with, somebody else is dealing with. If your spiritual master gives more blessings apparently to somebody else in front of you, what do you think? And the second aspect of it is our understanding on demigods. Once Srila Prabhupada was walking in Mayapur along with his devotees, when he was walking, suddenly he stopped. And he stopped and showed a group of ants that were, you know, going in a queue, one after the other. So Srila Prabhupada said that, you see this small group of ants, what do you realize out of them? So all the disciples, they couldn't, you know, respond, because different times Prabhupada has different responses to, you know, such examples. So they weren't sure what Srila Prabhupada is trying to teach out of this. Then Srila Prabhupada said that the way these ants are for us, we are for these demigods. If they think they can even crush us in no moment. So the point is that in our service opportunity, we should handle Brahma and all the other demigods in a very respectful way, because they are superior and they have got a very special, unique service opportunities, and they have not hesitated to take up a specific service, even though they are apparently in administrative in nature. When a service opportunity is given to us, we should not try to kind of question. We should not try to kind of get into a zone that this service is my service and that service is not my service, and we try to kind of compete or get into a competitive zone. So it's a very interesting scenario where your Lord in my house is no more my Lord attitude. It is very, very wrong attitude, and hence for us to get qualified in being part of Krishna's service agenda means we need to kind of cooperatively coexist, and that way the spiritual world, the spiritual activities will expand more and more. Otherwise, you will not be able to participate in them, and Krishna will not have anything to lose. So, finally, I will conclude with one single point where we need to know that we all are part of the spiritual world, and in our absence, when we were away from Krishna, the service of the Supreme Lord is definitely not compromised. But when we get back to the spiritual world, we resume our lost opportunity and continue from there. It is like in a Janmashtami festival, all of us are assigned some services, and when we don't participate in the services in that festival, our services are not, they are not stopped. Somebody else fill in that place and the services continue. But if we participate, then it is our prerogative that we get the service. In either case, that services are never stopped. So we need to realize that it is Krishna who is the doer, Krishna who is the benefactor, and Krishna is the ultimate controller of all that happens, and hence Krishna is Swarat. So to summarize our realizations today, Brahma is a post, and Lord Brahma is definitely having a limited span of his service opportunity. Unlimited from the perspective of a human lifespan, but very limited in comparison to the existence of his universe. So Brahma, being a qualified person, he is able to execute the service under the authority of the Lord, and hence every living entity can try or not try, may get an opportunity to become Brahma if they get into the right qualification. And even though this is applicable to Brahma, it is not the case for Rudra, about whom you will be discussing in the next set of series. So from verse 302 to 306, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorified about the Gunavatar nature of Brahma. And from 307 onwards, he is going to explain about Rudra. So Brahma, being the creator, he need to be in the mode of passion to perform the creation aspect of it. And hence, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explained that the person with past pious activities, with devotional sentiments, being a first-class living entity, is able to become Brahma. And if at some point in time he don't find a suitable candidate with this combination, then Krishna becomes Brahma himself. So the realizations that we spoke were, number one, Krishna is Swarat, services are unlimited, Krishna is eager to engage us in his service, and if we don't latch onto it, it's we who are the loser, not Krishna. The second set of realization was, Krishna is the doer and the benefactor. We just need to allow the Lord and his devotees to work upon us, and we need to remember that Krishna is a source of maintenance, and hence source of income is not our source of maintenance. Our source of income could be by our hard labor and our job, but our source of maintenance is purely the Supreme Lord. And the realization number three is that because Krishna is Swarat, and because our services are unlimited, let us better learn to engage ourselves in a very practical manner rather than in a sentimental manner. So we said that we will define about how and why to do the service, in what mode we need to do the service, so that the service becomes beneficial for our journey in Krishna consciousness. So we shared five sets of points under this third realization. Number one, that we can definitely take up service if it's the ultimate agenda is Krishna, then whether it is mode of goodness, passion or ignorance does not matter, as Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma are assuming the service of the mode of passion and ignorance for the pleasure of the Lord. The point was that sometimes devotees choose to take part in some service considering their external nature. So hence we said that our consciousness needs to be in mode of goodness and above, but the activities towards the service could be in anything if it is pleasing the Supreme Lord. So doing a service in a passionate way, because if you are not passionate, you can't do things. If you don't do things, then we are just some bookish daydreamer sitting and talking about some glorious service, but never pick up a simple Maslow's object for a Supreme Lord's service. So hence, being in any mode of passion or ignorance, but with the consciousness it is to please the Supreme Lord, is definitely considered a glorious service, like the Brahma who is trying to do the service in the mode of passion. And the second point we say that please take up service, that which we can chew, that which we can execute. So hence, we should ensure that our commitments to services are definitely which we can handle, and beyond which, if we take up and assume things, it will become an offense. And third realization under this third realization was that we learn to under-promise and over-deliver. So hence, our integrity and commitment is very nicely, need to be balanced. And this is need of an hour in our movement, because amongst devotees, we see some amateurish behaviors where we try to assume services just for the sake of proving an external reason rather than glorifying the Supreme Lord. And hence the fourth realization was, please don't compare and evaluate our service in comparison with what others are doing, because our service opportunity is with us and Krishna, and it has nothing to do with anybody else. And finally, please improve your service. Please invest your capabilities and time and energy in making sure your services are done with integrity and commitment, and inspire others to fall in the same zone. Improve, invest, and inspire devotees. And hence, the fourth realization is we need to tune up our attitude in such a way that we should not disrespect the position of Brahma, demigods, in anywhere lower, because they are all have assumed very special, unique services in spite of knowing the Supreme Lord's transcendental position. Hence, we need to be respectful towards them. And the second part of the whole realization is that whilst we are respectful, we should also ensure that we respect every service. We should not have an attitude of your Lord in my house is no more my Lord attitude. It is that the service only if I do it in this way, in this capacity, under so-and-so person is only a pure service. If it is gone, another person, then it is not a good service that I will choose. It is not something that is good for our spiritual journey. Hare Krishna. With this, I end here. If there are any questions or comments, we can discuss. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu, Dandavat Pranam. Thank you for the very, very excellent class. It was very insightful. I really like some points that you made about the consciousness and nature of service, that nature can be anything, but the consciousness with which we serve is so important. And then about how you have to take only as much as you can chew, otherwise it becomes offensive. So, and finally, another point that you said, service opportunity is between us and Krishna, and there's no question of comparison. So beautiful, very, very beautiful class, Prabhu. Very insightful. Thank you so much for being with us today. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you. Any questions or comments?
Hare Krishna, Ji Ram, Ji Sari, Prabhu, Koti Koti, Vantanda, Pranam to your Siva. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srila Gurudev ki jai. Thank you very much for your valuable association.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. I do have a question. It's concerning the relationship between Lord Brahma and the mode of passion, and we can also include Lord Shiva in relationship to the mode of ignorance. So I was wondering if my understanding is correct that although the mode of passion may be necessary to get certain things done. It is not that Lord Brahma is controlled by the mode of passion as those jivas who are in the mode of passion, as we say. You know, when we say that a person is in the mode, you know, in whatever mode, I think what we mean is that they are controlled by those modes. But in Lord Brahma's case and in Lord Shiva's case, I think that their activities are, let me say, maybe under the, I don't know if it's correct to say under the influence or under the control of those modes, but because of the elevated consciousness of Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva, they themselves are not controlled by those modes. So can you correct or confirm?
You're right and absolutely right. I'll give a very relevant example. Jayananda Prabhu. Jayananda Prabhu, the services that he did for Srila Prabhupada. If you categorize the services that Srila, you know, he does for Srila Prabhupada, he built that cart. He used to clean up the, you know, temple. I mean, it's very amateurish to even say that it's like kind of a laborious and shudra kind of work. But the idea is, when you classify from an external angle, intellectual class, administrative class, business class, shudra class, so a specific service demands us to be in a particular mode, and as you rightly said, but they are not controlled by that mode. So hence, that's my third realization altogether, is that please don't get, you know, locked up in the consciousness saying, oh, this is
Did we lose Prabhu?
Yeah, I think we must have, because I can't hear him either.
Okay.
Hare Krishna, I think a call is gone, so I am calling Prabhuji again, so please wait for a minute.
Okay.
Sorry, the call got dropped. Am I in?
I can hear you, Prabhu.
We can hear you.
Yeah, I was just saying that Jayananda Prabhu did some lot of services, and all those services were definitely considered as glorious to an extent that Srila Prabhupada considered his departure also glorious, and we celebrate his departure from this material world, and we, you know, worship him in the Rath Yatra cart everywhere all over the world. So the nature of service, that's the point I was trying to say as a third realization, is the nature of service may demand you to be in passion, ignorance or goodness or whatever may be the case. But our consciousness in which we do the service always need to be in the service attitude and supposed to be above all the modes. So Brahma, the kind of post that is chosen, person is chosen for Brahma's post is a person who is not carried away. You see, Jayananda Prabhu, the kind of people that he dealt with, he used to deal with one of the rogues and thieves and the drunkards and whatever you may call that area, then he needed to build the Ratyatra cart on that particular evening. When the rat broke, the next day's Ratyatra, he engaged. So there are a lot of people who could not deal with those people. Jayananda Prabhu dealt with them. But when he did deal with them, he was not getting affected by their consciousness. Rather, he was purifying their consciousness. So the principle behind this whole Siddhanta of services were that while Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, they are involved in such a kind of service, their consciousness is still pure, and that's what we need to inherit in our own, you know, lives as well. So I want to just confirm that yes, your understanding is correct, and I just gave an additional explanation to validate that.
Yeah. So just to really confirm for myself, so it is possible for, as in Jayananda's case, it is possible for a person's activities to be in one of the three modes, but the consciousness to be transcendental to the modes simultaneously.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes. There are a lot of alvars. I think one of the earlier classes I mentioned, I can give you a list of so many people who have kind of quote unquote not so usual behavior. You know, we see Sabari, she used to eat food and give it to, you know, the Lord Ram. Every food that she used to offer, she used to taste it first. There's a person called Andal Alvar in Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya. She used to wear the garland that she makes for the deities and wear it on herself, stand in front of a mirror, and used to give it to the Lord. If you see these behaviors, it may sound like a funny, amateurish behavior, but they were all meant meant in a very, very higher consciousness, and these devotees are glorified all over the world. So Krishna is definitely particular in deciding what our consciousness is rather than how do we do it.
Mm-hmm. So actually, after you gave that example, now I feel like I want to edit what I said. I think maybe it might be more correct for me to say that, you know, if your consciousness is transcendental, then maybe it's just that your activities only appear to be in the modes, but actually if your consciousness is pure, then your activities are also pure and transcendental, even though they have the appearance of being in the modes.
Yes, you can definitely say that. For example, let me go back to Jayananda Prabhu's case. That if somebody is needing to make rough cart, okay, that means actually in terms of the nature of work, some amount of passion, some amount of very hard labor. You need to really need to slog for 16, 20 hours to, you know, not sleep for 3 nights to put them together. But that's not the nature of a sadhu. So in terms of a pious brahmana. So what was mentioned is that in Varnashrama system, you have brahmana, kshatriya, vaishya, shudra. But Vaishnava is, a shudra could also be a Vaishnava, a brahmana could also be a Vaishnava. These four are just about the classification of service, the nature of service that they want, that they function. But there's nothing to define about their consciousness level. So a shudra Vaishnava is at the same position as a brahmana Vaishnava when it compares to the service of the Lord. The nature of service may vary. Vyasadeva sitting and compiling Vedas, Vedas and Srimad Bhagavatam is a kind of a great, glorious brahmanical service. But if somebody does a shudra kind of service, but so long as the nature of service is to please the Supreme Lord, then they are called, categorized as Vaishnavas only. But still this classification is meant because we can align ourselves, we can dovetail our psychophysical nature in the service of the Supreme Lord, and that's why Varnashrama Dharma is never considered the highest. when Ramananda Rai and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu discussed, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked Ramananda Rai to explain something. Then Ramananda Rai mentioned about Varnashram Dharma. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu rejected them, not because Varnashram Dharma is incorrect, but it is to say that we need to grow beyond Varnashram Dharma. Varnashram Dharma is a beginning and a good classification, but eventually we need to go beyond to an extent to say Krishna is the center of our life. I mean, any sense?
Yes, I think so. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much for your explanation.
Thank you, Bharati.
Mm-hmm.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, great. Thank you so much for letting me be part of this Sangha. Looking forward to more association in the weeks to come. Hi, Bob. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Shri Chaitanya Charitamrita ki jai.
Vancha kalpataru vyascha kripa sindhu vyai vacha patitanam bhavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Ananta koti vaishnavrinda ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Shri Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita ki jai. His grace Ram Giridhari Prabhu ki jai.
Thank you so much
Prabhu. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Wonderful class.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. Very wonderful class, Prabhuji.